Okay. So first of all, let me thank the organizer for inviting me here. And today I'm going to talk about some unitarity and positivity constraints for conformal field theory at large N. And this is based on our work in collaboration with Fernando Aldai. So the plan of the talk is this one. So I will start by introducing some notation, and I will introduce some basic fact of conformal field theory in dimension bigger than 2. And this will lead essentially to the definition of the problem that I would like to address today, mainly which is essentially the study of four-point function in N equal 4 superior mills with S2N gauge group and the crossing symmetry related to this four-point function. And then I will study the large N expansion and construct solution to the crossing equation and see which kind of consequences one gets for the spectrum of the theory. And if I will have time, I will also talk a bit about connection within causality constraint for effective field theories. Okay, let me start with some simple things. So conformal field theories in dimension bigger than 2 are described by the dimension of primary operators that can be extracted from two-point functions, and by the OP coefficients of primary operators that can be extracted instead from the three-point functions. The first non-trivial correlation function is the four-point function. And here I just wrote the 1 of 4 scalar operator. And this four-point function can be written as a function, a non-trivial function of U and V. And here some extra factor which depend on the dimension of the external operator. And here I just defined my cross ratios U and V, which are just a combination of distances. Now we can use the operator product expansion. So in this case, I have 2 scalar identical operators. So the first operator that appears in the OP is the identity operator. Then we have all primary operators and all the descendants. Now what we can do, we can expand our four-point function using the OP. So we can apply the OP between the first and the second operator and the third and the fourth. So I single out the contribution of the identity operator. And then if you look at this diagram here, I'm writing the four-point function as a sum over all the intermediate operator. And then we have the two three-point function coming from this two OP here. So this and this one. And since I have a four-point function of identical operator, I get the square of the four-point function and a function of U and V, which is called conformal block, which repack the contribution of of a primary and all the descendants. And notice that this coefficient here is positive because the three-point function are real. So now we can also use associativity of the operator product expansion. Namely, we can apply the OP between these two guys and these two, or we can do the OP between these two and the middle one. And of course, the result should be the same. And what we get from here, we see that actually when we exchange 1 with 3, we just switch from UV to VU, and we get some non-trivial factor here, which will lead to this equation. So what one needs to do, one is to plug back the conformal block decomposition in this equation. This is what's called crossing equation. Now, let me go and introduce the theory that I would like to describe, which is four-dimensional N equal 4 superior mills with gauge group SUN. So the four-point function that I want to study is the four-point function of half PS operator, which have a protected dimension 2, and they transform under the 20 prime of SU4 R symmetry. This four-point function can be written, again, in the same form that I wrote the four-point function before. But in this case, we have a sum here over all the representation that appear in the tensor product of these of 20 prime times 20 prime, because in this case there is also an R symmetry index. So we can write this four-point function as a sum over all the 6 representations appear in this tensor product. Now there is something that one can use in this case, which are superconformal word identities. And by using superconformal word identities, we can write we have some relation among all this GR. And actually, what it turns out that this four-point function can be written in terms of only one non-trivial function and two meromorphic functions and a constant. But for what I'm interested in is this function, which is the one that can be corrected, that can have loop correction. So now I would like to mention a bit which kind of operator we can get in the operator product expansion. So in the operator product expansion, in this case, we can have two different class of operators. So we can have operators belonging to long multiplets or operator belonging to short multiplets. Let me start with the short multiplet one. So trivially, we have the identity operator as the case, as the usual conformal case. And then we have half BPS operator and quarter BPS operator. For this case, the dimension of this class of operators is fixed, is essentially fixed. That depends only on n, which is the rank of the group. And also the three-point function is fully fixed. That again, it depends only on the rank of the group. Now, instead, if we go to operator belonging to the long multiplet, they depend also on the coupling constant, as well as the dimension that I will denote by the square of the three-point function that I denote by A. So now, then we can split the contribution of the four-point function in two parts. So this part essentially is the contribution of the operator belonging to long multiplets, and this part is the contribution of operator belonging to short multiplets. So as I said, this part here in principle can be decomposed in a superconformal block, but this contribution is fixed by because of these two relations here, and that can be computed completely. And this is essentially what was the one in the previous case, so in the usual conformal case. So before, I single out the contribution of the identity operator, which in this case is essentially this contribution here. For the long case, for the long operator, I can decompose this four-point function into superconformal blocks. So superconformal blocks just repack the contribution of the superconformal primary and all the descendants. And this is just a three-point function square. Okay, now here I wrote the crossing symmetry for this kind of four-point function. And then you can see that this left part, it just depends on the long part, and the right-hand side is essentially fully fixed, as in the previous case. So this is essentially what was in the conformal case, and then there is all the other bit. But this is completely fixed. Now, we would like to find solution to this equation, and solution to this equation can be written in this way. So we can write this GL as a part GLP UV plus this function here. Now, the way in which I decided to write this equation is that, so this function here satisfies crossing symmetry by itself. So it's a solution of this crossing symmetry. And then, of course, we can always add a solution which is that this crossing symmetric. Crossing symmetric means that it has this property here. So the first relation comes by exchanging 1 with 3, and the second comes by exchanging 1 with 4, position 1 and 4. Okay. Now, as I said, I would like to find a solution in a large n expansion. So let me start by the leading term, which is the one for n infinity. Of course, remember, the dependence in n comes from this right-hand side. So when I'm saying that I'm expanding in n, means that I'm expanding this right-hand side in n, and of course also this left-hand side I'm expanding in n through through this relation here, essentially. Okay. So again, this particular solution can be also, it has a leading piece plus a 1 over n squared correction. And the solution instead, the crossing symmetric solution, starts at order 1 over n squared. Then, at the leading order, what we have, we only have a double trace operator of this form. This operator has a dimension which is twice the dimension of the external operator, plus 2n plus l, where l is the spin. And the three-point function is fixed by this term here, essentially. Now, we would like to go to the solution at order 1 over n squared. Again, so at 1 over n square, all the these double trace operator that they were present at leading order, they get corrected, the dimension gets corrected by a contribution that goes like 1 over n square, so they get an anomalous dimension. And also the three-point function gets corrected. Now, if we are at very large lambda, that's it. So we only have this class of operators. And actually, if we require the absence of twist two operators, we have that we require the presence of supergravity. Because this part here, which is present, so this is just the 1 over n square of this part here, has, so in order to have a nice conformal Brock decomposition, we should have this combination here. And this combination here gives a correction to the anomalous dimension and to the three-point function. Now, if we move away from the large lambda limit, where lambda is just g square n, we have, as an intermediate operator, we also have a single trace operator. This single trace operator, they have a dimension which is of order n to the zero, so it's just a conformal dimension and some spin. And the three-point function is of order 1 over n squared. That's why they didn't appear before. Now, this operator appears at this order, then this the three-point function is positive for unitarity. While this correction here can have any sign, this one is strictly positive. I mean, it's non-negative. Then at finite lambda, there is a correction to the dimension of double trace operator due to this presence of this solution that can be associated to the presence of this kind of operators. We will see in a second more in detail this fact here. Now the rest of the talk is devoted to study these solutions in the regime in which single trace operator appear in the operator product expansion, and then we will see in which way the presence of this operator affects the anomalous dimension of double trace twist four operators. Okay, now I will introduce some technology that has already been introduced some talk ago. So, which is the Mellin amplitude. So, in this form, we can, in this representation, we can write the correlator at order 1 over n squared in this way here. So, in this way, we have this gamma function of x plus 2, y plus 2, z plus 2. This is what is called the Mellin amplitude, and here we have these factors. Now, we know that we only have two independent variables, which then there is a relation between z and x and y, which is this one. And what we see that this gamma function here has some poles, and this pole are at the position at the pole is equal to the twist of the double trace operator that appear. Also, crossing relation imply that the Mellin amplitude is completely symmetric in x, y, and z. Now, as we already heard some days ago, single poles of the Mellin at x are at x minus tau over 2 correspond to the presence in the operator product expansion of operator of twist tau. So, as soon as we have a pole of the Mellin, we know that we have a new operator which has this specific twist. Now, let's consider the simplest example. So let's consider a single scalar operator of dimension delta. So we only consider a scalar operator. And this operator has an OP coefficient which goes like 1 over n squared with some three-point function. Now, since we would like to have this exchange, we need to have a pole exactly at minus delta over 2, which is the twist over 2, as I said before. Then the simplest Mellin that we can think of is this one. So this has pole at the specific value that we want, and this fully crossing symmetric in x, y, and z. Now, this coefficient here is just a function of the dimension and the three-point function. This function is positive. By construction, this is positive for unitarity, then this object here is fully positive. Now there is a way of extracting the anomalous dimension by knowing Mellin amplitude, And then we can write essentially a relation between the anomalous dimension and the Mellin, and we can plot this correction. So here what I'm plotting the correction of the anomalous dimension of operator with spin 0 as spin 2 when I add a scalar operator of dimension delta, and I'm plotting this as a function of delta. So as you can see, for when the spin is the same as the exchanged operator, the correction for when tau, when delta is smaller than 4 is positive, but when tau, when delta, sorry, is bigger than 4 is always negative. When instead the spin is bigger than 0, the correction is always negative. Now, so okay, you can say, okay, this is a very simple example. Let's go on and move to a bit more complicated example. So this example instead is a general exchange of an operator of twist tau, spin L, and all the descendants. So again, the pole structure is essentially the one of before, but in this case, of course, instead of having the dimension, I have the twist, which is the dimension minus the spin, because in this case I can have also operators with spin. And I'm summing over all the descendants, so I have this k, which is the descendant level. And then what I have this polynomial here, which are related to the Mach polynomial. Mach polynomial are essentially mainly representation of the superconformal block for operators, for intermediate operator, that generic intermediate operator, also operator with spin. Now we will see in the next slide the behavior of gamma, but this essentially has the same feature of the one of this single scalar. Now let me point out a subtlety here. So now in this, when I write this the Mellin in this form, okay, again, this is the three-point function, which is always positive, and that's fine. But in principle, there is always an ambiguity in this definition, because I can always add a symmetric polynomial of degree L minus 1 to this equation without changing essentially the structure of the pole, since, as I said, this will be a complete regular term. For the moment, I will set this term to 0, and I would like also to notice that for spin 0, since this is a polynomial of degree L minus 1, for the scalar case there is no ambiguity at all. So this is just the full answer. Okay, now let's study the contribution to the dimension of double trace twist four operator. And then for a single trace primary operator of twist tau and spin L, the correction to the anomalous dimension is, so if we look to spin different from the one of my intermediate operator, we have, so on my single trace operator, we see that the correction to the anomalous dimension is always negative. So for instance, in this plot, I just draw the exchange of an operator with spin 2, so we see that the correction to the anomalous dimension of double trace operator is always negative here, as spin 0 and spin 4. Instead, for the same spin that as the new operator that I'm introducing, you see that for tau bigger than 4 is always negative, and here can be positive or negative. In this case, it's positive. Okay, so what this mean? So which kind of lesson can we learn from this? Now we can be a bit more systematic and see which kind of relation we can actually get. So as I said, this correction that we are computing are correction to twist 4 double trace operator. So as I wrote one of the first slides, there is always a term in front of the block which goes like u to the delta minus L over 2. So since here the twist is 4, 4 over 2 is 2, so we are looking to terms proportional to u square. Or analogously, we have to look to terms which have x equal to minus 2. Then we can write the correction to the anomalous dimension in this form here, where this fj of y are the continuous Hahn polynomials, which have been introduced also in another talk some days ago. And actually what we can check that this function, this continuous Hahn polynomials, when tau, when the twist is actually equal to 4, that reduces exactly to this Mach polynomial here. And instead, when tau is bigger than 4, we can write this polynomial, we can write them as a sum from j that goes to, from 0 to L on this, we can write this kind of decomposition with all positive coefficient. So what we have seen that we can always write for tau greater than 4 this kind of relation here. So now let's see what this gives to us. So if we have all single trace operator with tau greater than 4, then the contribution to the Mellin amplitude at x equal to minus 2, then z is equal to minus y, satisfies this relation here. The one, essentially what we can do, we can rewrite p in terms of this function f. And this kind of decomposition has all the coefficients which are positive. Then, if you remember, gamma goes with a minus sign in front, then this means that the correction to the anomalous dimension is always is always negative. Then we can also write this kind of relation because the M is fully symmetric. Now let's see a bit stronger constraint. So what we can also do, let's assume that for a fixed spin, our twists are ordered in this way. So again, this is the twist of the single trace operator, and this is the spin that we are choosing. So if they are ordered in this way, then what this means? This means that we can always write the Mellin in this form with coefficients which are positive starting from the value of tau bigger than 4, because as I said, these positivity constraints hold when for tau bigger than 4. Then, again, for in this case, for L star, L star plus 2, and so on, the anomalous dimension will be always smaller than 0. And this is, of course, is a bit stronger than the one before, because before we were assuming that all the operators has to have tau greater than 4. In this case, if they are ordered, this kind of relation holds for all the rest of the operators. Now, actually, this kind of constraint can also be derived by assuming the regular behavior of the Mellin amplitude. Now, let me go to the consequences on the spectrum that I mentioned before. So what we can learn about our spectrum? As I said at the beginning, the dimension, so this is the dimension of double trace operator with twist 4, is given by 4 plus L. So this is the correction due to supergravity. As you can see, this correction is just negative. And then here we have this correction due to some extra exchange. Now, we see that if the single trace operator that we are considering has tau smaller than 4, then where tau is the twist of the minimal twist operator, then tau, if tau min is smaller than 4, then tau min is the minimum twist for the fixed spin that we have. Instead, if tau min is smaller than 4, then 4 minus this gamma 0 L sugra is an upper bound for the twist because this term here is always negative. And this is also is negative and is also always present. Actually, this upper bound has also been observed with the numerical bootstrap. So what the numerical bootstrap was observing, it was observing that for large n, the bound was saturated exactly by this, this value. So what we are showing here is that if one does this kind of analysis, one sees exactly that the only correction that one can have has negative sign. So this provides an upper bound. Okay, I think I don't have time to explain the causality constraint, but just in a word. So there are some causality constraint on the effective field theories, and this causality constraint have been studied by these people some time ago. And actually, the way in which they studied this is by studying the S matrix of a low energy effective field theory. And what they saw that there should be some positivity constraint if we want that our theory has a consistent UV completion. And what they study a specific limit. The specific limit that they study is the forward limit. And then they study the regular part of the S matrix. And they saw that it has to have an expansion of this form where all these coefficients has to be non-negative in order to be a consistent UV completion. Now what we can do, in our formalism, the connection between this the S matrix and the 1 over n contribution comes by taking the flat space limit of the Mellin amplitude. So one can essentially use this nice relation given in a paper by Penedones. And then by taking exactly the forward limit in our case, we see that also in our case we need to have an expansion of this form. And when we take the flat space limit, we see that only the leading term survives in the flat space limit, and all this coefficient has to be positive. So what we have shown that positivity constraint in the flat space limit are equivalent to the one of causality. Essentially, we are again saying that the leading term here are all positive, which is essentially equivalent to this statement here. Okay, let me conclude. So in what I discussed in this talk, I discussed the solution at order 1 over n square to crossing symmetry of a four-point function of half BPS operator in n equal 4. And then I study in particular a regime in which in the OPE there are also single trace operator as well as double trace operator. And then what I study the correction to the anomalous dimension of double trace operator of twist 4, which get correction which has a definite sign, and this correction can be tracked back to positivity properties of Mach polynomials. And then what I just sketched at the end was the relation between this positivity constraint and causality constraint from effective field theories. So thank you very much.
Positivity that you have, that the flat space S matrix have because of causality, that follows directly from the positivity that the Mach polynomials have.
Exactly, yeah. So what you can do, you can use the flat space limit. In this case, again, you can have a connection between a trivial connection. Then what you can do, you can exactly take the forward limit, and you get from the positivity of this coefficient here, because
that positivity comes from
the same positivity as before. Essentially, what I did here, I just expand this m in terms of this f of j that I had before. And then we know that all this c has to be positive, and this is exactly the same. No. Actually, it cannot be perturbative because I'm assuming a gap, a twist gap, so it cannot be perturbative.